Hi, welcome to my video explanation for the San Francisco casque. Image number 1, verse 10, with the famous book The Secret, A Treasure Hunt by Byron Preiss. I hope you liked watching that intro as much as I enjoyed doing it. I chose Walter Murphy's Fifth of Beethoven song. This is a reference to Ludwig van Beethoven, the famous music composer and pianist. You will understand later in the video why I chose the song. Okay, so now let's start with our verse. We start at a statue in Golden Gate Park, a statue named our national pastime. And I'm gonna explain why we start here. So let's first have a look at the verse. In the shadow of the gray giant. I know this sentence has been mostly associated with the city of New York, but I think the gray giant we are looking for is actually this statue here of a baseball player in San Francisco. You might know that the baseball team that is located in this city is named the San Francisco Giants. So it is natural to think that a statue of a baseball player in the city of San Francisco is a giant. And this statue is gray, so a gray giant. Now, if you look at the history of this statue, we see that it was sculpted in 1889 by a man named Douglas Tilden. And if you know your history, you will tell me, well, there were no San Francisco Giants at the time, so this is not a gray giant. You have a good point, but if we look at the history of the San Francisco Giants, we learn something interesting. This team was actually founded in 1883 in the city of New York, and they moved to San Francisco in 1958. And now, the big clue we have to understand that this is our gray giant is in the book. If we go at the page 89 and we look at the picture associated with the text Team Spirits. If we look at this picture, we see a man named Monte Irvin, who is a former baseball player who died in 2016. And this man played for the New York Giants. And if we look at the picture, he has the shirt of the Giants, but he has the hat of the San Francisco team. But he never played in San Francisco. He played before 1958, at the time the team was located in New York. And we also have on this picture the three other baseball players behind him with the New York shirts on. I think that Byron Preiss intentionally tried to mislead us into thinking that In the Shadow of the Gray Giant was the Statue of Liberty, and this image in the text, in the book, The Secret, A Treasure Hunt, this picture at page 89 with the baseball player of the New York Giants team that has the San Francisco hat is a big wink to this statue in Golden Gate Park of a baseball player that is not a giant, but you understand. So I think we really have our gray giant here, and if we start the quest from here, well, it makes sense. Now let's look at the rest. So now let's go on with the verse. We have the next sentence that says, "Find the arm that extends over the slender path." This sentence is pretty easy. We just have to look at the baseball player statue and find the arm that extends when he throws the ball. And that seems to indicate us to take the Nancy Pelosi drive to continue our quest. And this is a slender path just because in comparison to the JFK drive, that is the other avenue which the statue is on, well, it's a smaller road, so that's just what it refers to. Now the verse continues with, "In summer, you'll often hear a whirring sound." For this sentence, I saw many explanations on the internet, but none were really satisfying. But there is an explanation for the city of San Francisco that fits very well. If you think about the things that make San Francisco famous, there is the fog. You have probably already seen before photos of the city with the fog. And the fog is a phenomenon that can happen during winter, but that is mostly prevalent during the summertime. So this fits with the sentence and the whirring sound. Well, this is just the boats entering the San Francisco Bay. They have what we call a fog horn, and it makes a very special sound. And it's typical of the city. If you search fog horns San Francisco on YouTube, you'll see many videos of this. And this is a pretty solid explanation for this sentence, and it's really a good clue that we have to take this text to solve the San Francisco casque. So the next line of the verse is "cars abound." I have seen many explanations for this line about other cities, and it was always about the fact that there were many cars in the city, etc., etc. But here I have, I think, a good explanation for this one. It's if you look at the Google Street View from Golden Gate Park in San Francisco, you will see that people just park along the roads that cross through the park. This is kind of unusual for a park. If you look at other well-known park, like I don't know, Central Park in New York City, you don't see that. And in my hometown, usually we have a parking area at the entrance of the park. People park there and then they walk in the park. But in San Francisco's Golden Gate Park, it seems to be common habit to just park along the roads. So I think the line "cars abound" is a reference to this kind of unusual situation. Now the verse goes on with, "although the sign nearby speaks of Indies native, the natives still speak." This part of the verse had my wife and I scratching our heads very much, but thank God my wife came up with something very interesting with the native part. Was thinking that this must be someone or maybe a tree or plant, but actually this is a reference to a bird. Yes, there is a place very close to the baseball player statue in the Golden Gate Park. Only a couple meters from the statue on the opposite side of the street, there is this place named Peacock Meadow. Now, the peacock, also known as the Indian peafowl or the common peafowl or blue peafowl, is a bird native to the Indian subcontinent. Oh, how interesting! So we probably have the answer here to our Indies native. And now the other part where it says the natives still speak. Well, this is a reference to an event that happened in the city of San Francisco from November 1969 to June 1971. There was a 19-month-long protest during which 89 American Indians and their supporters occupied Alcatraz Island. So this is a major event that we don't talk really much about these days, but when the book was made in 1982, it was still kind of fresh news. So I think the natives still speak sentence refers to this event, and you can search about that if you want on Wikipedia, occupation of Alcatraz, and you can read the article. Now there is this interesting thing about the peacock. If you look, and it's just a theory, but it's very interesting, if you look at the eye of the girl on the image from the book and you turn it sideways, you see like the shape of the eye kind of looks like a peacock, and also the feathers of the peacock look like eyes. So is there something there to be seen, like the eye of the girl looks like the peacock whose feathers look like eyes? Well, I don't know, but to me I see it, and I think this is a big clue. Okay, now let's go back to the verse, and it continues with the line of "him of hard word" in three volumes. This is a weird sentence, and this is, I think, a reference to Shakespeare. And I have good reasons for that, because in the image there are other clues that are leading us to the Shakespeare Garden, and I'm gonna explain those clues in a few minutes. But here, of him of hard word in three volumes. If you have ever tried to read Shakespeare works, you have you probably know what I'm talking about when I say that it's complicated. There are very strange words for us moderns, and the way the sentences are built is kind of strange. And exactly like this sentence, actually, of him of hard word in three volumes. This is a weird sentence, a weirdly constructed sentence. And also, like I said, there are strange words that are hard for us to understand, so of hard word. And the other interesting thing is that Shakespeare is credited to be the inventor of a word. This word is honorificabilitudinitadibus. So honorificabilitudinitadibus. If you want to have hours of fun and pleasure, try to pronounce this word. If you search about this word in Wikipedia and you read the article, you will see that it is associated with Shakespeare. He used it in one of his texts. And this is a word that starts by the letter H, and if you noticed in the verse, the word hard is written with a capital letter, so that might be a reference to this particular word, of him of hard word, of the man who invented this word. So this is a theory, but I think it is interesting. And the other thing about the three volumes, well, Shakespeare's work is separated in three parts. There are the comedies, the histories, and the tragedies. Often it is presented in three volumes, but even when there are more volumes, it is historically considered to be separated in three, and those are the three. So this sentence makes a lot of sense if we look at it with Shakespeare in mind. And you will see we are anyway going to the Shakespeare Garden. Oh, and also there is another interesting thing here, is the fact that Shakespeare really frequently mentioned peacocks in his work. If you search about that in Google, Shakespeare and peacocks, you will see that he often refers to this bird in his text. He particularly liked this majestic feathered friend, and this here is very interesting for us because, as you remember, I spoke about the peacock garden, the peacock meadow, just a few minutes ago. So here we have a reference between Shakespeare and peacocks. This is another clue that we are going in the right direction. Okay, so let's go on with the verse now, and it says, "Take twice as many east steps as the hour or more from the middle of one branch of the V." Now, if you remember in the beginning of the video, I said that the arm that extends over the slender path was the arm of the baseball player that seems to indicate us to go on the Nancy Pelosi drive to go on with our quest. Now, I found a newspaper article from 2012 that tells us that Middle Drive East would be renamed Nancy Pelosi Drive. And we can conclude that in 1982 the name of this road was Middle Drive East. And that is interesting because in the verse we have the words middle and east right here. So there, I don't think we really have to count anything here regarding the hours or the steps. There's just the reference here to the road is enough to understand that this is the way to go to the treasure ground. And now if we walk until the end of this road, we get to the intersection with the Martin Luther King Drive. And the intersection between those two drives, Middle Drive East and Martin Luther King Jr. Drive, has a V shape. And this is the V we are looking for. And now, in the middle of one branch of the V, well, we have a smaller branch here, and exactly in the middle of this branch, we have the entrance to the Shakespeare Garden. So I think those lines here are the path we have to take from the statue to go to the treasure ground. And we have other clues actually to help us understand that the Shakespeare Garden is really the place to go, and I'm gonna explain that right away. And also, if you notice, the we have the slender path here that makes sense because in comparison to the Martin Luther King Drive and JFK Drive, we can really see that Middle Drive East is a relatively small road from the Golden Gate Park. So the sentence makes sense. Now let's see. So that takes us to the Shakespeare Garden. As you could see, I talked about the peacocks that were a reference to Shakespeare, and we also had the line of him of Art Words of Art Word in three volumes. And now we're gonna look at some clues on the image that makes us think that the answer is very close to the Shakespeare Garden. If you look at the image, over the head of the lady, there is this rocky mountain, and we have a window-like figure on top of the mountain. Well, if you look at this this window, well, it really looks like the Shakespeare statue here in Golden Gate Park. There are two gates, one on each side of the statue, and those gates were installed to prevent vandalism. And when they are closed, well, this really looks like what we have on the image. And now, if you take a look at the image once again, and you look beside the lady, we have this table with the clock on it, and this is really similar to the sundial here in Shakespeare Garden. And actually, we can put ourselves right in front of the sundial, and we look at the window at the other end of the Shakespeare Garden, and this really looks like what we have here on the image. We are standing right next to the sundial. We can almost touch it with our hand, and we have this little window at the other end of the garden here. So if we put ourselves right there, just like on the image, and we look at this clock that we have, the clock indicates us with the hands on it. It indicates us that the answer, when we are this position, looking in the statue at the statue of Shakespeare, well, the answer is right behind us. And now you will see that the answer is in fact right behind us, and I will explain that in the last lines of the verse. So now the last part of the verse really gives us the answer here to where we have to dig. Look down and see simple roots in rhapsodic man's soil, or gaze north toward the Isle of Bee. The three lines here that are very important are look down and see simple roots in rhapsodic man's soil. Rhapsody is an adjective that can be used to describe music. And if I read the description, it's rhapsody in music is a one-movement work that is episodic yet integrated, free-flowing in structure, featuring a range of highly contrasted moods, color, and tonality. Well, this is interesting, and if we look very close to the Shakespeare Garden, we actually have two statues of famous composers. We have the Ludwig van Beethoven statue right here, and we have also the Verdi statue. And the adjective rhapsody, rhapsodic, can be used to describe their music. So this is very interesting. And now I also have this picture here where I zoomed in with Google Street View, and we can see that there seems to be quite impressive roots here. And that is also interesting with the sentence we have here. And now we have to think, look down and see simple roots in rhapsodic man's soil. Where can I be if I'm looking down to see those two statues here? Well, the only place I can be is right here on this little hill, right between the Shakespeare Garden and those two statues here. And what is very interesting is that it fits perfectly with what the clock was telling us when we were at the sundial, remember? It was pointing us right behind where we were standing. So this fits very perfectly with what we were looking for. And now the last little sentence. As you can see, we don't really need the last two lines of the verse to find the secret location where the casque is buried. But I will still give you an explanation for those two lines. So the verse reads, "Our gaze north toward the Isle of Bee." So the best explanation we could find to explain this one is in the De Jong Museum. If we stand at the treasure ground and we look directly north, we have the De Jong Museum. And inside this museum, there is an important oceanic art collection. And in this collection, we can find many pieces that come from the Batak people. And the Batak people are from the Sumatra island in the country of Indonesia. So Sumatra, could it be the Isle of the Batak people? Isle of Bee. So I think this could be the explanation. Maybe there's something else, but I could not find anything that fits with this sentence. Now there are two last things I want to show you about the image. Two things that really confirm that we probably have the good solution here. If we look back at the image number one, we see the big rectangle with the dragon, and that is a representation of the Golden Gate Park. And as many people have already stated on the internet, the strawberry is a reference to the strawberry island that we can find in the park. And the very cool thing here is that if we lay the two images on top of another, the image of the park and the image with the lady, and we try to match the strawberry right on Strawberry Island, we find that with her hands crossed like this, there is a small empty area between her hands, and with this area she is circling the spot where we think the casque is buried, the Shakespeare Garden and the hill behind. So this is a very good clue. She seems to be telling us, yeah, it's right there, look. So that is one major clue. And the other very cool thing that we actually found out after finishing the video, we were watching it back and we saw this. If you look at this image with the gate at the entrance of the Shakespeare Garden, you can see the words Shakespeare Garden are reversed, and I put this other image here to show you more clearly the letters. Those are the exact same letters that she has on her dress, the G and the H, and they are also reversed. And if you notice, the G is a capital letter, just like the G of the word garden here. So this is a pretty good match. We have the G of the word garden, we have the H of the second letter of the word Shakespeare, which is a small H. And now we have the jewel in her neck, who seems to be floating over the letter as well. This is just telling us, hey, if you're looking at the sign from the sundial, looking back at the sign, you see the treasure is there, floating over the letters of the word Shakespeare Gardens. So this is, I think, a big clue to tell us, yeah, the solution, the treasure is buried right on top of this hill right here. So this was too interesting not to put in the video, so that's why I chose to re-edit it and put this scene on. So I hope you enjoyed watching this video, and see you later, alligator. If you